Welcome to Qt Widgets and More, and welcome to the fourth episode of developing a plugin for Qt Designer. This episode, we'll actually develop the plugin, finally. But before we put on the jingle, let me just show you what it looks like in real life. Now, I have a file chooser up here. You can actually see that file chooser line edit and this push button. I have a date selector over here, and if I press Control R for run inside of Qt Designer, you can actually see that I can choose dates. The widget works. That's what we'll see how to do in this episode. To develop a plugin, you need to do two things. You need to provide an instance of a subclass of the plugin interface. That class tells stuff like what is the name of the plugin, and it also has a factory method for actually creating the instance of that widget that the plugin represents. And the second thing you need, and that took me quite a bit of Googling around because I was far from obvious from the documentation, is that you need to provide a collection of the plugins. The documentation tells you how you create a single plugin, but you cannot create multiple of those. You need a collection if you want multiple plugins in your application. And of course you do. You have more than just one widget that you want to make a plugin of. Let me show you first the plugin class. The plugin class is subclassing, and I'll only say it this once, subclassing from Qt Designer Custom Widget Interface. And let me just press F1 here so you can see what that looks like. It has a number of pure virtual methods that you must override. What Qt does is it'll find that DLL somewhere on your disk. Then it'll take that and it will fetch this Qt Designer Custom Widget I was about to say it again. I don't want to say it more than once. It will fetch that thingy, and then it will instantiate that. And from that, it will get all the information about the plugin. So let's see what they are. It's the group that it goes into. So if you look at the UI file here, then you can see that, that's why. You can see for KDAB viewer, I have a bunch of different groups, states, teams, regions, and so on. So that's the first one. Then it's the name of the widget. And it is the name literally. So if your widget is called QFooBar, then you cannot just give it the name FooBar because that would look easier on the eye of the user of this. No, it's called QFooBar. So it's literally the name. I think that is a fuck up somewhere in the design of this whole thing, because why would I even need the name? If you give it a different name, Qt, whenever you load this plugin, will come and say, hey, it's a different name, that's not good. And then it will just ignore that name that you provided there. Then the include file, that is when you are instantiating this widget in your generated code, then it needs to include this particular file. It's just like the include file we specified when we promoted the widget. And this one is super important, namely the instantiation of that widget. And that widget, that instantiation takes the usual parent pointer. And let that be a warning here. Please do get a pen and a paper now. Whenever you create your widgets for promotion, you must use this parent. I had a crash that I was looking at for quite a while because I just ignored that parent, but you must use that parent. So class myFooBar special widget colon public queue widget, there your constructor must take a parent and it must give that parent up onto the queue widget superclass. Okay, tooltip, what's this? If there's tooltips and what's this, when you hover over the sidebar, an icon, so that's this beautiful KDAB viewer icon that you can see here, you can provide your own if you have skills to do that or people that can do that for you. Is container, let's just ignore that. it's if it's a container that you're creating, so think a tap widget or something like that. If you're creating that, then you need to do special things and you need to tell that, yes, this is a container. It's beyond what I'll be covering in this episode here. It's initialized, and initialized, we'll see those in action in just a bit. So I was sitting there creating a number of subclasses and repeating writing the same API over and over again until I came up with the idea, what I'm really is just changing is these few parameters. So let me make that into some class, and that's what you're looking at here. So the class looks like this, tooltip. I couldn't be bothered. What's this? I couldn't be bothered. I couldn't be bothered. Is container false? This is the constructor taking the group, the name, the include file, and the factory. That's the instantiation of that widget, taking those and just copying them over. And group, just return group and include file, and so on. You can take this literally as it is and just copy it over and use it. And yes, you're very welcome. Remember in the last episode, I told you that you are likely want to make a plugin out of your application, because you are likely not going to be able to take those widgets that you want to make plugins of and pull them completely out and compile them on their own. And if that happens, then you are likely also not want to run a proper instance of your application whenever it's used in Qt Designer. So let me give you an example. In KDAB Viewer, I have a nice login box where people of KDAB Viewer need to provide their credentials. I don't want a login box to show up every time I am using Qt Designer. So what I do is that I actually has a flag inside of KDAB Viewer where I say, we are running in Qt Designer mode now. Please provide fake data wherever needed instead of actually going and reading from the database. And that's exactly what is initialized, and initialized is you good for. Is initialized tells you, or you tell Qt Designer, whether it has actually initialized. And you can either, as is the case here, I initialize once for all of my widgets, or I could initialize them individually. And then in the initialize, you get a Qt Designer form editor interface pointer where you can get a lot of details about different parts of Qt Designer. And then you will do your initialization. So in KDAB Viewer, for example, I had a system settings class with a static method that's saying set provide fake data. And I called that one. And then KDAB Viewer would behave slightly different based on that. And then I call the is initialized, or I assign to that variable saying, yes, now we have been initialized. We are not done yet. That was the easy part of creating the actual plugin. The hard part is compiling that and getting the generate or the compiled files into the right directories. The last part, I've actually dedicated a whole episode on setting up CMake for that. This time, however, we will see the compiling part, and then we'll just copy it in place by hand. So now again, I'm the CMake expert, right? Trust me, I know very little about CMake. The stuff above here is what you've already seen. It's in the previous episode of this series here, so go and watch that. That's one line, though, that is new, namely line 38, saying CMake shared module prefix. To be honest, I cannot remember exactly what it does, but it, among other things, means that the libraries on Linux will not be prefixed with lib because they are, well, the modules will not be prefixed with lib because they are not libraries per se, they are modules for plugins. It seems to be the standard, just copy it into your code. And here's the specific part for this plugin. And let me just add a few blank lines here so you can see it for my face. It goes like this. Find the package Qt 5 UI plugin. That tells us to go and find that specific CMake file that we can use for this. And then I say, I want a new library called QWAM plugin. It's a module, meaning a plugin, and it is a compiling. Oh, when I'm compiling in the QWAM plugin CPP, and QWAM plugin collection.cpp. That's those two files we've been seeing in this episode here. Then I tell it that the target link library, that means that this library here should have Qt widgets and QUI plugin set up in its include path and set up for linking. And then I simply say that my plugin should link against this QWAM lib. And in case that you're a bit confused about all these WAMs, QWAM plugin is the plugin that Qt Designer will load. QWAM lib is my application as a library. Again, previous episode, we made our application into a library. And now I can press build and it'll compile. And well, did that pretty fast. Can't have been much to do. And now there's just one thing left. Come on, Jesper, stop with all this. There's just one thing left. Let me see it in action, please. Okay, you asked for it. Here it is. Isn't it beautiful? Here is my promoted file selector. Yeah, it doesn't look like much, does it? See, the problem is that we still haven't deployed it. That was what I was about to tell you. You need to copy those DLLs that we got compiled here into specific directories. So that's for us to do next. But imagine that you have a coworker that did not deploy those plugins and he loads it in. He will see just the empty widget here, but he can still work with it. He can still fix a spelling error in here. You can see that my promoted, it just looks like a promoted widget up here called file selector. Had it had some properties that I would have specified, they would show up as dynamic properties. So unless he started messing with that one, he could still make changes to other part of the user interface. So you need to copy that DLL with the plugin into one or possibly even two directories. For reasons beyond my understanding, Qt Designer looks in two different places for its plugin, depending on whether it's a standalone designer or whether it's a designer that is inside of Qt Creator. So you need to copy that DLL into those two different places. And second, in case that you actually made a library out of your application, then you need to copy that to the directory containing the Qt Designer or Qt Creator binary. So if they are in different places, you need to copy them to both of those too. And the reason for that, well, you only need to do that if you're on Windows. I've got to say that. On Linux, C++, whatever, we'll figure it out using the run path or the R path. But on Windows, you need to have it in the path. So either you take your build directory and put that into the path, which will be annoying for people that just want to run Designer, or you take it and you copy those to the directory of Designer and Creator. And let me show you that last step. Welcome back. As a good TV chef, I already prepared the dish, and here are the three copying lines that I need. I need to copy blah, 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 build, blah, 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 blah. That's just where my compilation ends up in. QWAM plugin.dll, that's the plugin itself. That's the one with the collection and with the plugin. That one I need to copy to this directory, which is where Qt Designer standalone expected. I also need to copy it to this directory, which is the directory where Qt Creator find the designer inside Qt Creator find it. And given that I'm on Windows, I also need to copy the QWAM lib. That is the one that was split out from my binary. Copy that next to where my designer and creator are. Fortunately, they are in the same directory. Otherwise, I would have had to copy it to two different directories. And now with that, I'm ready to show you my plugin in action. You see, if I scroll down here, here we are, Qt date selector and date selector and file chooser, and you can see they are the real plugins now. Yeah, go away. I also can show you that they are working inside of Qt Creator, and I'll show you why. Well, I'm not sure why, but I'll tell you why I didn't start it or why I closed it down. That's what I'm trying to say. I closed it down because QCreator obviously needs to load that plugin. And just because that it ends up in a directory where QCreator knows doesn't make it load right away. You can see it's in here right now. But another reason I tell you is because you can just as well get ready to do this, because Windows has this annoying thing where you cannot copy to a file that is currently being used. Qt Creator uses that plugin, so you cannot copy to it while Qt Creator was running. Had I tried to execute this line up here, or well, both any of those lines, I would simply get a permission denied. That is not very useful, Jesper, that I need to go to my shell and copy three or run three very obscure copy line every time to deploy my plugin. I know. Forgive me. In the next episode of Qt Widgets and More, I will show you the CMake magic to make that happen. Until then, have a great time. Ah, you're still here. I'm glad, because there's one piece of information I forgot to tell you, but it was on purpose because I want you to watch my videos to the very end and through all the advertisers and stuff at the end. The piece of information is right down here. Let the eyes follow the mouse. It is right here. I'm compiling in release with debug information. That is super, super important. If you try and compile with debug, and you are on Windows again, yes, Windows is where all the problems are. If you try and compile with debug, and you're on Windows, and you deploy the plugin into a Qt Creator or Qt Designer that are built in release mode, they will simply not load them. There you are. Better watch my videos to the end. This is the end. Bye. Over and out. Come on, yes, but stop with all this. That's just one thing.